Good morning. It's good to greet you on this beautiful Lord's Day morning. It's not snowing and it's not raining and the sun has been shining. It's a good day to greet you. A couple of announcements for your attention this morning. Of course, a reminder of the pew pads and the prayer and praise notes inside them for your use. We appreciate the altar flowers in loving memory of Judy Schertzer, presented by Ken and the family, and we greatly appreciate those this morning. And I need some input because I'm not sure the arrangement that is on the platform here. Thank you. This is, and that is probably inside. Donna is on the ball. The centerpiece is in loving memory of Sandy Riddle's mother, Marion DeLong, who passed away in the last week, and we greatly appreciate those flowers. And while we're talking about that, do you want to take a minute to introduce your family?
Sure. My daughter and her husband, Ashley and Brian, are with us with my two grandchildren, Ella and Lincoln. Sitting back there with Sandy.
Welcome. Donna asked me to remind you that there are Easter Lily order forms in the narthex on the table. If you intended to order one, haven't done that yet, this would be a good time to do that. Take one home with you, fill it out, return it. This Wednesday, of course, our Sabbath study. And April 5th, if you enjoy painting, we're going to give you an opportunity to do that. There's information in the bulletin about the painting opportunity, April 5th at 6:30. And again, if you have questions, you can check with Sheila Long or Carol Schock. I believe that's all the announcements we have this morning. If there's nothing else, let's take the time to be quiet before the Lord as we prepare for worship this morning. Thank you.
let's stand. We're going to sing our call to worship. We're going to do it a little differently. We're going to split the group. I guess this group is going to be the strong side because of the choir. You're going to be over here. You're going to follow me and Darwin. This side over here is going to follow Carol and Donna. Okay? Because Carol's going to play the other part. Now, let's make a joyful noise unto the Lord all the earth. So if it doesn't go right, just make a joyful noise. It'll be fine. But we're going to try. We're going to sing it in a round. I think we decided we're going to sing it twice because we might have to practice the first time. So Bob's going to put the slide back again. So here we go. This side first. Ready? Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all the earth. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all the earth. You guys had a trickier part because we got the words before you did and you lost your last phrase, but it's a pretty simple phrase. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord. So now we practice. Let's do it again. Ready? Same way, this side first.
Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all the earth. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all the earth.
Everybody together, great is the Lord.
Great is the Lord, he is holy and just. By his power we trust in his love. Great is the Lord, he is faithful and true. By his mercy he proves he is love. Great is the Lord and worthy of glory. Great is the
So grateful for your presence among us this day in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated.
We are going to be reading responsively, but note that follow the prompts, but don't follow the slides. Okay, I think there's like two slides for the leader, two slides for the people. So just make sure you follow the prompts on the slides, but it won't be every other slide. It is good to praise the Lord and to make music to your name, O Most High, proclaiming your love in the morning and your faithfulness at night, to the music of the 10-string lyre and the melody of the harp. For you make me glad by your deeds, Lord. I sing for joy at what your hands have done. How great are your works, Lord! How profound your thoughts! Senseless people do not know, fools do not understand, that the way that through though the wicked spring up like grass and all evildoers flourish, they will be destroyed forever.
The righteous will flourish like a palm tree. They will grow like a cedar of Lebanon. Planted in the house of the Lord, they will flourish in the courts of our God. They will still bear fruit in old age. They will stay fresh and green, proclaiming, "The Lord is upright. He is my rock, and there is no wickedness in him."
Sing along with this video.
Lord of heaven and earth,
Lord of creation,
Lord of heaven and earth,
Lord of all creation, of water, earth, and sky. The heavens are your tabernacle. Glory to the Lord on high. God of wonders beyond our galaxy. You are holy, holy. You declares your majesty. You are holy, holy,
Lord of heaven and earth, Lord of heaven and early in the morning, I will celebrate the light. When I stumble in the darkness,
you'll be my guide.
I will call your name by night.
God of wonders beyond our galaxy, you are home.
Your mind.
Ask the children to join me at the front of the sanctuary. Glad you guys are all here this morning. I have a story I want to tell you, but I need to find out if you know what two particular animals are. I'll show you the first one up here. Do you know what that animal is?
A turtle.
It looks like a turtle. It's a kind of a turtle, except it never goes in water. It's called a tortoise. Can you say that word? Tortoise. Now I'm going to show you another animal. What is this animal?
A rabbit.
It's a very special kind of a rabbit. It's called a hare. Not this kind of hare. But it has longer ears than and it's also very, very fast. So on the screen we have a tortoise and a hare. It looks like a turtle and a rabbit. And the story I'm going to tell you is about a tortoise and a hare who were friends. That seems strange, a fast animal and a slow animal. Do turtles go fast?
No.
They go slow. And do rabbits go fast?
Yeah.
They go really fast. Really, really fast. Well, this slow turtle and this fast rabbit, the slow tortoise and the fast hare, were good friends. And one day, the hare said, I think we should have a race. You know this story. So you can help me tell it. The tortoise lined up at the starting line, and the hare lined up at the starting line. And they were just about to take off for this race. And all the animals were cheering them on. But everybody thought, this is kind of strange. The tortoise can't possibly win this race because it's too slow.
Yeah, because the rabbit is going to win.
You think the rabbit's going to win?
Because
it's so fast.
Rabbit.
But you don't think the rabbit's going to win? Well, let's tell the story and see what happens. The rabbit takes off, and it's so fast. It is way, way, way down the path before the tortoise even starts. And this tortoise is going really slow, like a tortoise does. And the rabbit got so far down the path, he looked and he said, man, my friend the tortoise is really slow today. In fact, he is so far behind me. What do you think he did?
He took a nap.
I mean, there's a time to take a nap, but when you're only halfway finished with the race, that's not a very good time. So the hare took a nap and he's sleeping, okay? So meanwhile, what's the tortoise doing?
Walking.
He's walking. And he keeps walking. And he doesn't slow down. He doesn't stop to take a nap when he's not supposed to. This is a time to keep moving.
Yeah.
And he kept moving, and he kept moving, and he kept walking. And he walked right past the rabbit, right past the hare. And he kept on going until he got to the finish line. And he was just about to cross the finish line, and the rabbit woke up. And he said, oh no, I slept too long. And he ran and ran and ran and ran. But he didn't get to the end in time, and the tortoise won! I told you that story to remind you, there's a time to rest. Do you guys like naps? Do you guys like naps? You don't like naps. I'm going to ask them, do you like naps? I told somebody, I saw a really cool t-shirt that said, Dear Naps, please forgive me for hating you when I was a child. But you guys don't like naps very much. Someday you'll appreciate them a lot more. There's a time to take a nap. But when you're doing work and you get tired and you want to quit, don't quit. Keep going like the tortoise did. Because when you keep going, even when you don't want to, that's how you win the race. You keep going, even when you're tired.
But I am airy. And there's no one needs to be.
Before you go, I'm going to pray for you, okay? Let's pray together. Dear Jesus, sometimes there are things we have to do that we really don't want to. So please help us remember this tortoise. Teach us how to keep going even when we're tired and don't want to, because that's how we win the race. You prayed in Jesus' name. Amen. Cole's hiding.
Yeah, I'm smiling.
Okay. Caden, you want to show everybody where to go? You can head out now. Whoops. We would not trade these kids for any amount of money in the world. They are so infinitely precious. And we're glad they're here. At this time, we're going to ask the ushers to come and receive your investments in the work of God's kingdom this morning.
Let's stand.
Thank you.
even in the midst of the brokenness and the things we don't understand, you are creating something of beauty in each of us. We are so thankful that you do that, Lord, and express our thanks in this tangible way with the prayer that you will use these gifts that others may come to know the wonder of the God who brings beauty from ashes. And we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. Carol Klein has a word of praise for good results on procedures for me. God is so good. And asks us to pray for George as he waits on the outcome of biopsies on his arms and ear. God is in charge. We give it all to him. Janice Ensminger has returned home from Hershey Rehab, and I appreciate Ron Miller mentioning that, and Helen Grumbine also assures us that Jan Ensminger is home. But at this point, she continues to need constant care, continual care. So we're asked to continue praying for her and for Helen with some medical issues that she is dealing with. Karen Burkheiser has asked us to pray for her brother-in-law, Rick Hay. Is it Hay, Karen? He's having eye surgery Thursday, March 21st, to bring the pressure in his eyes down. The drops are not working anymore. The surgery is at 11:30, Thursday morning, 11:30, March 21st. Carol Schell has a word of praise that her brother Alan, some of you may know Alan Klein, retired pastor of the EC Church, he is getting a kidney transplant, or word of praise that he has received the transplant. And she asks us to pray that the kidney will fully wake up. It is working but needs to fully function. That will take some time, so continue praying for Alan. And I got word this week that Bob Wartlift has gone home from rehab, so we're grateful that the Lord is working in all kinds of ways, in all kinds of people. Let's take the time to pray together. We're going to take some time this morning, as we often do, just to be quiet for a few moments before the Lord as we prepare our hearts to be with him. Gracious God and Heavenly Father, on this day we gather together to stop. For a time, setting aside what the work week has been and come into your presence to acknowledge that you alone are truly Lord. There is not a square inch of this planet or its people over which you cannot say, "This is mine." We come here acknowledging that we occupy a world that is severely broken. We've lived through a week in which natural disasters have wreaked havoc in people's lives. We've seen so much evil inflicted on people by people. And yet this is the very same world that you created, world for which you died. And even though we don't fully understand all the complexities of this world, we believe that you are a good God, that our times are in your hands, and that in your perfect time, you will work out all things to the good of those who love you. And so this morning, in the quiet, we lift to you the concerns on our hearts and minds. Thank you so much for the ways in which you have been working in the lives of every single person in this room. Sometimes in ways that we can see, sometimes in ways that we can't. And for those that are obvious and visible, we give you thanks for the way you've touched Jan Ensminger and Bob Wartlift. For the way you've kept Alan through the transplant, and we continue to pray that this amazing miracle of technology will also experience your touch in his complete healing. We pray for Rick Hay, his surgery, and for Karen, as she also holds him up and supports him. Thank you for the good news from Carol Klein. And we continue to pray for George. Grateful for their willingness to give all of what happens to you, knowing that you will do what is best. Thank you for Helen. Continue to work in her life, her physical frame, her spirit. And we thank you so much for Marion DeLong, her life, the confidence we have that she is in your presence right now. And pray that your comfort and your strength will be with this whole family as they have to say goodbye for now, but anticipate that reunion one day. Thank you for those who are visiting with us today. Will you bless them for having been here today? And will you give eyes and ears to us to see and hear and understand your word? Continue working in us to will and to do according to your good purposes. And we pray this all in the mighty name of Jesus, who taught us to pray, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen."
Jesus, bless us.
Reading this morning from the book of Genesis, chapter 1, beginning at verse 31. God saw all that he had made, and it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day. Thus the heavens and the earth were completed in all their vast array. By the seventh day, God had finished the work he had been doing. So on the seventh day, he rested from all his work. And God blessed the seventh day and made it holy, because on it he rested from all the work of creating that he had done. Perhaps you saw the news item. An elementary teacher recently made headlines when she insisted that one of her students wash off what she thought was a dirty smudge on his forehead, not realizing that that was actually the sign of the cross he had received at his church on Ash Wednesday. I was not struck so much by the fact that this teacher didn't know what that thing was. It's possible in this day and age, during the Lenten season, those who are not familiar with how churches do things may not recognize what that was. What concerned me was the fact that the number of Christians who were offended by the fact that this woman should have known what that was. After all, we Christians have rights in this country too. How dare she? What concerned me was the fact that as followers of Jesus, we have the privilege and the responsibility to convey the reality of Jesus to a world that doesn't know him. There's a way we can do that that is winsome and welcoming and lets people see the beauty of Jesus. There's also a way that we can do that in which we become not the persecuted, but we become the obnoxious. And it does not help the cause of Jesus when we try to take a stand for him in a way that gives offense, not because the cross is offensive, that's the reality, but because we become obnoxious. There's a better way to communicate the beauty and reality of Jesus into the lives of people that's available to us on a regular basis, but far too often we don't avail ourselves of it. And that is with the Sabbath. And so the question becomes, for those of us who live in the 21st century, as busy as life is today, is there still a place for Sabbath? Aren't we free from the law? Pastor, I really would like to observe a Sabbath, but the fact is, I'm just too busy. And yet, the Sabbath is one of the Ten Commandments. None of us is going to be particularly guilty of taking a pistol and shooting someone. We kind of pride ourselves on the fact that we don't do a whole host of things like the Ten Commandments, but the Sabbath thing that can be a little questionable about how well we do that. It is a commandment, but that was back then. This is now. This whole Sabbath thing, the word Sabbath is not actually a holy word in Hebrew. It simply means stop. You come to a stop sign and you stop. Now, in our day and age, when you come to a traffic light, the red light is on. There's nobody coming either way. And so you have to sit and wait for this stupid red light. When you're in a hurry, you've got things to do. Why am I sitting waiting for this dumb light? Now, there's a law that says if you make a stop, there's nobody coming, you can make a right-hand turn and keep on with your busy life. Our life does become like that often. We are so busy, we have so much to do, and don't have enough time to do it all. Sabbath feels like this quaint old-fashioned notion, which was fine back in the days when Anvil and Cleona were more like Mayberry, but this is the 21st century. Who has the time for Sabbath? The challenge for followers of Jesus is to live out the Sabbath in a way that doesn't degenerate into legalism or get frittered away into good intentions that really don't accomplish anything. Sabbath means stop. On the seventh day, God stopped his work of creation, which means that one day in seven is built into the creation as the need to stop. We want to be careful not to try to do Sabbath in a way that was never intended by God. How many of you are comfortable washing your car on a Sunday? Or mowing the grass on a Sunday? A number of years ago, people in my neighborhood know that I'm a pastor, and since pastors typically can't take their Sabbath on a Sunday, it's the one day that we do actually work, so we have to find some other day to Sabbath. You didn't laugh. That worries me. Thank you. I mowed my grass. I don't typically do this, but this was one of those weeks where everything was busy. I mowed my grass on a Sunday and bagged it. And we have a neighbor who is part of a plain church, and he's a farmer, and he's agreed to let people in the area bring their grass clippings to his farm and pile them there. So I thought, yeah, it's Sunday, but I'm a pastor, and my Sabbath has to be some other day. I bagged the clippings and took them to his farm, and I drove up and said, I'd like to drop these off today. And he said, Pastor, it's Sunday. You should know better. Was I thinking? Is it sinful to mow your grass on Sunday? And the conclusion that many of us will come to is, for me, it's sinful to mow your grass on Sunday. It may be fine for someone else, that's their conviction, but my personal conviction about Sunday, since that's the day I choose for Sabbath, is I can't mow my grass, I don't wash my car. There are a number of things I don't do. And I don't stand in judgment on someone else who does, I just don't do it for myself. That's a practical outworking of how Sabbath can work, because we can't all take a day of Sabbath on Sunday, but those of us who can, try hard to practice it faithfully. We want to be careful not to let it degenerate into something legalistic. But what do we actually do on Sabbath? What was it designed for? It wasn't designed for us to avoid a whole host of things. Sabbath was designed by God. And I'm going to give you a couple of things. First, it is a day to renew and refresh our relationship with the Lord and with each other. Not all of us can take a Sabbath on Sunday, but those who can, this is part of its purpose, to renew our relationships with each other, with Him. Sabbath also is designed to help keep us separate from the world. We Way back when the Lord called Abram, his intent was to create a nation of people who would be different from the world and show the world what a relationship with God could be like. Sabbath is part of that process. When the people of Israel fell into idolatry and were carted off to Babylon, the Lord promised them that they would be able to return one day. And when the new king came to town and allowed the Jews to return home, many of them did. But when they got there, they realized that the wall that protected Jerusalem was gone, was destroyed. Back in Babylonia, a man named Nehemiah, who was a government official working for the king, became aware of the problem. There's no wall protecting Jerusalem. So he and some of his cohorts made their way back, and they began this project in which the wall around Jerusalem was rebuilt. They did it in only 52 days, just an absolutely amazing experience. But the purpose for rebuilding the wall was not just to protect the city from an invading army. Part of the purpose of the wall was to remind God's people that on the Sabbath, they were not to do commerce, which means all those Gentile people who were used to bringing their wares into Jerusalem and selling them on the Sabbath, we're not going to be allowed to do that anymore, because God's people had to be unavailable to those folks outside and available only to the Lord and each other on that day. The wall wasn't just to protect the people from an army. The wall was to protect God's people from losing sight of who they were and being just like everyone else. This may be one of the most difficult aspects of Sabbath. To be able to say, I'm not available to certain people. It may mean shutting off your phone, closing the computer, and on the Sabbath, whatever day that you choose to Sabbath, to stop, you're not available to work. You're not available to the hiking club. You're not available to certain people with whom you do commerce on a regular basis. You focus on making yourself available to those people who need you most. Family, perhaps your spiritual family. Sabbath is designed to help remind us to be different from the world. And sometimes that can cost us something. People won't understand. But it's important to do. In 1979, Gene Wilder, the actor, was in a movie called The Frisco Kid. Wilder plays a Polish rabbi who's coming from Poland to the United States to establish a synagogue. So when he gets to Philadelphia by boat, he is taken in by some con artists and loses everything. Well, a horse dealer named, but portrayed by Harrison Ford, befriends this poor benighted rabbi and promises that he will help get the rabbi to San Francisco, where there's a group waiting for the rabbi to come. So in the process of traveling across the country, some bad guys accost them, and the bad guys are on horses. They've got their guns. They're getting close enough that they're pretty soon going to shoot the rabbi and Harrison Ford. The rabbi, this particular day when they're being chased by the bad guys, is a Sabbath. And you know, Sabbath lasts from sundown Friday till sundown Saturday. It's Saturday, the sun's going down. Jews cannot ride their horses on Sabbath. This is a conviction this rabbi has. It's what he's been teaching. So he is walking his horse with the bad guys coming, and Harrison Ford is on his horse screaming at the rabbi, "Will you get on the horse? We got to go. Those guys are going to be here any second, and they're going to shoot us. You got to get on your horse." And the rabbi just keeps walking his horse, keeping an eye on that sun. And just as it breaks the horizon, at that point, Sabbath is over. He gets on his horse, and they take off, and they get away from the bad guys. It wasn't a great movie, but the point he was making was, if you're going to be serious about Sabbath, it may cost you something because you'll be a little different from other people. But they need to see the difference. This is the reason that you Sabbath. Sabbathing becomes a testimony to people around us that 24/7, which is where our world is right now, is no way to live. But the 24/6, taking that one day to not be available, allows us to be fully human as God intended. Sabbathing is also a reminder, and this is important for us. I don't know if you have a control freak in your family. Some of you are looking at each other right now. I got to tell you, the world is full of them. And the reality is, many, many, many control freaks are married to people who are not, and it makes life interesting. Doesn't it, sweetie? There are days when I think I would probably not be here were it not for the fact that my wife is as conscientious as she is. The word control freak has some real negative connotations to it, but the fact is, it's a personality style, and thank the Lord that there are people in this world who are detail-focused, and it's important to them that things be done well, that things be done right. But those very same folks do have difficulty letting go of things. They make absolutely fantastic employees, because they're the people who will stay late. They're the people who will come in on Sunday. They're the people who will work and work and work and make sure the job is done and you know it'll be done right. They're the very same people who desperately need to remember that one day a week I have to let go and give it to God. And that's tough. But it's the reason the Lord gave the Sabbath, not as a suggestion for our health, but as a commandment. Sabbathing is a reminder that we are not in charge and that we can trust the Lord to keep things going for our best while we practice resting in Him. One last thing that Sabbath does for us. If you've ever had in your home a hidden drip, someplace behind the walls where there's water dripping, and you're not aware of it, and it drips and drips and drips and drips, and the wood does not do well over time with dripping water. And finally, when there's a sudden sag in the floor and you can't figure out what's going on, and you pull up the floorboards and you realize that one of the joists under there is sagging because the water's been dripping and there is a horrible case of rot that has set in. It's not just a small problem. It has endangered the whole house. Those who stay busy all the time can have a very serious case of soul rot and not even know it. One of the purposes of Sabbath is to slow us down long enough to be quiet and look inside and say, Lord, is there something here that I really don't want to look at, but I need to? That kind of slowing down to look can be very painful. And sometimes it's the very reason we keep busy, because we don't want to see what hurts in there so much. The busyness anesthetizes us to where the real problem is. Sabbath forces us to slow down and look and do a spiritual MRI and ask, Lord, what's here that needs your attention and your healing? So when you go out to eat this afternoon, one of the amazing things I've found, how many Christians eat out after church on Sunday? Let me ask you briefly, what's your opinion of going to a restaurant on Sunday after church? Don't tell me what you think I want to hear on the basis of this sermon. What do you do and why? Is it a problem for you? It's handy. Situations require you to do that, so it makes it handy. We say grace. Anybody else actually go out to eat Sunday after church? Oh, come on. I've been out to eat with some of you. Yeah, but this is church, and I'm not supposed to say that kind of stuff. I might get in trouble with God. Oh, you think he hasn't noticed? I think it's another one of those deals that if my personal conviction is I ought not to eat out on a Sunday, then don't. But if you are free to do that, do it. But when you do, there are some interesting ways to redeem that time. Here's one that's going to really, really put me in lots of hot water with every Dutch person here. How do you tip? Tip? Do I tip? How about increasing your tip as an opportunity to extend the grace of Jesus to your server? But do you have any idea what kind of a miserable, messed up mess this person has been? The point is not to say, give them what they've earned. The point is to say, I'm extending the grace of Jesus to them and doing to them what I'd like to have done to me. Here's another one. I've only done this once in all the time that I've gone out to eat, but it was a fascinating thing to happen. Our server happened to be a waitress, and she came, took our orders, and at one point in the course of ordering, I just asked her, how can I pray for you? And then when she got over that initial shock and thought for a few seconds, she started sharing a real personal concern. And then she left, and the man that I was having breakfast with and I prayed for her while we shared grace. The whole transaction took about 2 minutes. Is that one way to extend a Sabbath grace to someone? One man that I read about tips 100%. He's committed to the sanctity of the Sabbath, doesn't like to eat on a Sunday because it makes someone else work. So even in the course of his work, sometimes he has to go out to eat with people and to provide a Sabbath blessing for their server, he will tip 100% and say, or write on the bill, "God bless you." Nobody's ever refused him. Nobody's ever complained to him. And often they come and say, "Thank you for that." Sabbathing becomes a testimony to people around us that 24/7 is not a way to live. 24/6 is how we were designed to live. Finding creative ways to Sabbath that will help us be different from the world, unavailable at certain times, so that we can be fully available at other times. And then using the Sabbath to bless people. Will you think about that today? And then while you're thinking about it, will you find a creative way to Sabbath? Let's pray. Lord, you didn't stop working because you were tired. You were setting an example for us. One day in seven, stop. Our world, of which we are a part, has lost sight of our limitations and our need to stop. So please help us to be the people who express your grace by Sabbathing. And thank you for making that time, that experience, so rich and full of yourself that we find rest. And we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's stand.
Thank you.
May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you his peace. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, and God's people said, Amen. Amen.